I just want to thank Aldo for the invitation to be here tonight with you. This has been a long relationship and partnership with AB Medica, and they've seen us in both good times and bad times. Obviously, the Italian tie to Intuitive Surgical has been a long one. Starting, our first prototype was called Lenny, which was a nickname for Leonardo. And I think the engineers didn't feel like it quite justified Leonardo, but Lenny was okay. The second prototype was called Mona, after the Mona Lisa, which was painted by Leonardo. And then, of course, our third prototype was Da Vinci, and that's what has stuck. But we have other projects going on, and there's a group of our software architects who are all Italian, come from here and there. And so some of the names of our projects, one of them is called, which I'll show you a little bit, it's called Ducati. And then we came with a kind of a smaller version of it, and it's called Vespa. So that, you know, we have a history of Italian names for our products. I'm going to start out with something that has nothing to do with surgery, but does anyone know what this is? Well, this is the first transistor. It's changed your lives. It's the thing that, you know, allows your cell phones to work, your computers, everything else. And we sit right in the center of Silicon Valley. But the reason I show it to you, this was developed at Stanford University in 1947. But I show it to you because disruptive or breakthrough technologies are often born ugly. And so some of the things that I'm going to show you today, Aldo asked me to talk about the history, is some of the uglier portions of the development of this technology. My first video is from Stanford Research, where this technology began.
World and would grasp an instrument that feels like a surgical instrument, reach into this world, and begin to manipulate objects in it.
The final telepresence instrument will have even greater capabilities than the model demonstrated here, and will be designed to pass through conventional trocars. And the dual cameras will be replaced by a special stereoscopic laparoscope.
Imagine doing closed surgery with your hands, your instruments, and your eyes inside the patient's abdomen. That's what telepresence can bring to surgery. We're very enthusiastic about the prospect for telepresence, and so are the surgeons who have the telepresence experience. This is only a beginning.
So this was the beginning. This was the technology that we licensed out of SRI, and with the goal of enabling surgeons to perform complex surgery through very small incisions with greater precision than is possible with the human hand. Now, the way we thought we'd do that is we would apply wrists to those instruments. We could bring wrists to them, give wrists back to the laparoscopist, bring intuitive movement so that left is left and up is down, up is up and not up and is down. As you see with intuitive, with the laparoscopic surgeon, skilled hand motion, tremor elimination, and magnified 3D. So this is where we started. We had a quarter of this building. This is just off the Stanford campus. We shared this. The other half of the building was Roger Staubach, who was a quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. It was his real estate company. And I tell people we got so tight that somebody had to stand up before somebody could sit down. But this is a picture of the lab. You can see these engineers are still with us, but the first prototypes. This is the first surgeon's console. Now, I'd ask you, would you have invested in this? In fact, Aldo brought me out here, got me to come here, and we visited a lot of bankers. Nobody invested. So this was the patient side. Now all you needed was a wrench and a screwdriver, and you could use this in the OR. And then this is Gary Guthart, who was a young engineer in it then. Now he's our president and will replace me as CEO at the first of the year, but doing a demo. And this demo, I'm sure, was for some venture capitalists trying to raise money. Most of them came, looked, and walked. And this is when we shipped the first system in late 98. One thing about California, in December, it's still nice weather. So the first system was what we call now the Da Vinci standard, but it was the Da Vinci then. It eliminated a lot of the lap compromises. It provided, you know, the wristed instruments, the intuitive movement, the elimination of tremor, etc. And then the first improvement to that was the fourth arm. So we had a fourth arm, and that was introduced about a year and a half after we introduced the standard. And then along came the S, which is we put HD 3D in it, and then visual input, so you could do overlays and real-time information to the surgeon, multi-quadrant access, streamlined setup, and procedure-specific energy instruments. And then, of course, the system we have out in the foyer here is the SI that was introduced beginning of this year, which provides dual console, even higher resolution HD vision, superior ergonomics, increased surgeon control, and scalable architecture. This will allow us to do a bunch of things, which we will be introduced in the future, and of course, advanced instruments. And I'll talk a little bit about that later on. This kind of introduces the S system.
It's called the Da Vinci robot. We have one of them here, and I'm joined to tell us more about it by Dr. Matt Hewitt and Professor John Higgins from Cork University Maternity Hospital. John, how are you? Matt, how are you? Matt, you've actually used this machine, have you not?
Yeah, I have, on numerous occasions. It's an amazing piece of technology.
Now, we asked our audience to volunteer. None of them put up their hand to have a little surgery done live in the studio. So instead, we have got ourselves a grape.
Yeah, an ordinary grape.
What are we going to do with this grape?
I'm just going to peel the grape.
You're going to peel the grape,
yeah,
with Da Vinci.
Yeah.
All right, well, you get yourself set up, and we'll have a look at that in a few moments. Now, John, how many of these devices are there in this country?
Well, there are two, Pat. There's one in Cork University Maternity Hospital, and there's one in Galway.
And that's it?
And that's it.
How many are there worldwide?
There's about 750, I think, worldwide, though the number is increasing pretty rapidly as people have begun to realize that this technology is not just experimental. It, in fact, has a very large role to play in the future of clinical practice.
It's incredible. The grape's being cut. Little scissors at the top of the probe is actually cutting the flesh, not the flesh, the skin of the grape.
I think, from a surgical point of view, it would be hard to imagine doing that with your own hands. I mean, you would know what you want to do, yeah, but the grape is so small, and you've got a natural shake in your hands that's removed by the robot. So you're magnified. You're getting rid of some of the actual defects of traditional human surgery.
Looking at the grape, it's just peeling away a little bit of the skin. It's quite sensitive and extraordinary.
You'd have to imagine inside the human abdomen, as it were, that could be a covering layer of an organ. It could be one of the covering layers out at the walls of the abdomen. Every piece of equipment we bought, we wanted to buy it at the very best level. That's how our Irish hospital system is going to improve. And this robot allows us to do surgery on patients that normally would stay in 4 or 5 days. They potentially can stay in one day and go home. Now, the biggest cost in healthcare is a night in hospital. That is a huge economic burden for all countries. Mm-hmm. And if we can move patients from 4 or 5 days to 1 day, you can rapidly justify the cost.
Matt, I think you've done enough. You've done very well. Well done, Matt.